Hello and welcome to Filmy Ladies. We are back with an episode on another woman superstar of days of yore. And today it's Zina Damon. I could not be more delighted because when I was looking through my list of movies that I've seen 25 of her films. And we had a YouTube commenter who, when we were talking about Sharmila Tagore, said, wait, Sharmila Tagore, actually one of my favorite actresses, and I didn't realize it. And I kind of had that reaction to Sharmila as well. And I'm kind of having that reaction for Zenith because she is in a lot of things that I love and I always enjoy her in them. So I'm like, I may be giving myself a new appreciation for Zeenat Aman, of course, aided by her recent Instagram appearances, which are so delightful. I know she's kind of having a moment.
She's so boss lady. I love her.
But, you know, I have always liked her. I've seen her at, I went to the IFAs in Canada all those years ago and she was there. So I've seen her in person. Like, she just seems so cool. And I really enjoy her in films. And I'm really delighted to talk about her with you.
Yeah, I'm very excited too. I remember when, because like we have this Google Doc with like all the female superstars in it, like by chronological order of debut. And I remember you were like, okay, so who's the next one we're supposed to do? And I was like, Zenith. And you were like,
because she, so Rekha also obviously is a 70s superstar, but Zenith, Rekha seems to to have endured longer, at least in my mind, than Zenit did. I'm not saying that's true, but I think the impact of Rekha is longer chronologically, maybe. And so Zenit to me is the most 70s of the people we've talked about so far. And obviously, like I have a pair of giant sunglasses and they're in the car, and I'm really sad that I didn't put them on because they're like big,
Why are they not on? Giant sunglasses, and I should have worn a straw hat because we're going to talk about the one movie whose screenshots we were giggling over.
This is the time where regular listeners will not be surprised to hear us say that Dev Anand has entered the episode and he will not be going anywhere because you cannot talk about Zina Daman without talking about Dev Anand. Maybe she's the last of our women for whom that's true. So let's send him off with a bang because he's really here.
We will also be talking about Manoj Kumar.
Oh boy.
It was so hilarious to me that we were going to do a Zenith Aman episode and the co-stars were like literally two people that we have such like mixed feelings about. And I'm being nice when I say mixed feelings. Yeah. So the movie you watched was Hare Rama Hare Krishna, right?
Yeah, which I had not seen before because I feel like it's a film that everyone talks about for the song and just the one song and then Zenith's outfits. And sometimes that's enough to make me watch a movie. let's be clear on that. But somehow for this one, you know, like hippies as scapegoat, which is kind of what I understood it to be about. Somehow I was like, meh, like that is a plot that doesn't super appeal to me. And a friend on Twitter actually said last night when I said I was going to be watching this, she said, no plot, just vibes.
Oh, nice.
And that is kind of
just an extended commercial.
Yeah. And it, you know, there's more going on in the movie than I had kind of thought there would be. So that's a shame on me. I should have done my research better. And I'm glad to have watched it. I did find it a little long and a bit draggy at times, but I have no regrets about having seen it. I'll probably never watch it again. But obviously it's a piece of her star text and I'm glad to get to talk about it.
Yeah. I've actually watched Hare Krishna in bits and pieces because it was one of those movies my grandmother really liked. So she had like a few films. She loved Amar Prem, Aradhana, Kurbani, and I know her favorite song of all time was Aap Jaisa Koi Meri Zindagi Mein Aaye. She was a strange
woman of taste.
She was a woman of impeccable taste. And then she also loved Hare Ram Hare Krishna. And for some reason, these four movies, they would show them a lot on TV. Mm-hmm. So, and like my grandma would keep up with like, okay, so on Sunday, they're going to show this movie or whatever. So she would, you know, play it. So I've seen this movie in like bits and pieces here and there, but never actually bothered to see the whole thing. And I would always tune into the songs. And also this has Mumtaz in it, right?
Does.
So she has some really cute songs too. Like I love Kanchi Re, Kanchi Re. So I used to watch it for that, but I actually have never seen this movie. The movie I watched is also a movie I've never seen. I have avoided it for a very long time. And that movie was Roti Kapda Aur Makan, which surprisingly I liked. However, having said that, I also then needed a very strong martini to recover.
Before we get into our respective films, what are your thoughts on Zeenat Aman in general? And I'm interested to know who do you like her with as a romantic pairing on screen? Because it's not Dev Anand.
No, it's not Dev. It's never Dev Anand. I think the one thing that always struck me about Zeenat Aman is that she was... So, you know how back in the day, you would have the heroine and you would have the vamp and the twain could never meet. They had their specific roles. And then eventually, because heroines started doing a lot of things that the vamps were supposed to do, thank God. Mm-hmm. And then the vamps kind of got phased out because their USP was like taken over or whatever. I think Zeenat Aman was one of the early actresses where you could see those two things blending. Like, I distinctly
remember...
And she
says that about herself as well. She talks about herself as being kind of a heroine with a bit of gray.
Yeah, because she's played like a mistress, which, you know, heroines never played mistresses. They were either the love interest or they were the wife. Or they were like someone who had been wronged, but they were never a mistress by their own choice. The mistress was always like Aruna Irani or Bindu or Helen or whatever. But Zeenat Aman actually has played like mistresses. She plays... there's a movie she did with, I think, Rajesh Khanna, which has very good songs. That, if I remember correctly, she's a very ambitious woman and she gets pregnant. She's married to Rajesh Khanna and she wants to have an abortion because she feels that being a mother at that point in time will impact her career, which also a heroine would never do because, you know, there's all this tyag and all that stuff you're supposed to do. So she's done a lot of like very unusual stuff. Also, in terms of her costuming, I mean, she was gorgeous. Had an amazing figure. And so they would put her in these fairly, like, for the time, extremely revealing outfits. But what is interesting is, you know, the heroines never wore the revealing outfits. And then the vamps always wore the revealing outfits. But Zeenat, I think, had such an sort of, like, elegance and, like, almost like a sophistication to her that despite certain directors' best efforts to try to cheapen her, she always looked like a million bucks. And I am talking about
Raj Kapoor.
Yes, we are talking about Raj Kapoor. Because, I mean, there's obviously someone like Feroz Khan, where he presents his heroines in a beautiful light. Are they wearing bikinis? Yes. Are they wearing very skimpy clothing? Yes. Are they singing in nightclubs? Yes. But the way he views his women, I have personally never found it sleazy. I've never found the way he presents them sleazy. But then you see something like Satyam Shivam Sundaram with Raj Kapoor, and it's just, it's ick central. The fact that Zeenat Aman can pull that off and not be icky is truly amazing to me, because I do not know how anyone could not be icky in that movie, because it's the gaze of Raj Kapoor that is so gross. So to me, that was always like mystifying. But I think that was kind of the thing. Like, she could walk that tightrope of like heroine and a vamp. And I think in many ways that made her relatable. Like, you know, I think another actress who kind of pulled that off before her was sort of like her precursor, but never really achieved superstardom, was actually Saira Banu. Saira Banu kind of did the same thing too. She just, I don't think, had the acting chops where she could be like a huge superstar, but she kind of did that a little bit. Mumtaz did it a little bit, but Zeenat is really the one that really embraced, like, you know, the gray roles. Her role in Roti Kapra Makan was very interesting, and that's actually why I wanted to watch it. Because I wanted to watch it because of one line. I was reading the premise of the movie, and it said Zeenat Aman plays Sheetal, who is Manoj Kumar's girlfriend, and she dumps him because he's unemployed. And she chooses instead to be with her rich, handsome boss, Shashi Kapoor. And my husband is so rude. I read out that line to him and he goes, "What? However will Zeenat Aman choose? Manoj Kumar, Shashi Kapoor, wow, what choice will she make?" And I was like, "You were so rude." But I found that so interesting because, again, that's not something heroines do. Heroines stick with their man, even if the man is, say, Devdas. Even if he's terrible, they do not leave his side, even if far better men show up. And in this movie, the fact that she's willing to, like, dump Manoj Kumar and go with Shashi, I was like, okay, first of all, good choice. But also, second of all, how did you pull that off? So that's actually why I wanted to watch the movie. And to answer your question, I think I like her best with Amitabh Bachchan, because I think physically they look very good together, just like Amitabh and Rekha. Like, they're both tall, lean people. I like Amitabh with Rekha, Amitabh with Parveen, and Amitabh with Zenith for the same reasons. I just think they have really good chemistry. So he's not someone I particularly like, but together they are great. What about you?
I've mostly seen her, I think, with, I've seen her with Shashi Kapoor quite a few times. I mean, unfortunately, that pairing is very much overshadowed by Satyam Shivam Sundaram, which is a revolting film. And he's so good at being so awful in that film. So I kind of...
He's very punchable in that movie.
Yeah, it's kind of hard not to shake that shadow from their pairing when I see them other places. I like her with Dharmendra quite a bit. Yeah, I don't have a strong feeling about who I think she should be paired with. I've liked her with various people.
Yeah.
And she's just in so many of these fun 70s things that I love so much. So I'm just, you know, usually just happy to see her show up. So
remind us exactly what it is, the story of the movie you chose, apart from the vibes bit.
Yeah, so just vibes. This was not known to me. Dev and Zeynep play siblings.
Yes, there's that song, Fuloka Taroka.
Yeah.
It's very famous.
And so the film opens with them as children in Montreal,
where
horrible Western values have apparently cracked apart this family because the parents hate each other and are about to split up. Side note, I feel like Canada is never the homeland of bad Western values in an Indian film. So
no.
I was like, oh, US and Britain are both like, not us for once.
Yeah.
So, you know, that was kind of interesting. They don't do anything with the Canadian part of it, obviously. So then Dev and his mother go back to India.
Okay.
And he grows up to be a pilot, an airline pilot.
Oh dear.
Not like an Air Force pilot. And
thank God.
she stays in Montreal with the dad, but is sent off to boarding school. And then she kind of become and his dad, the dad remarries to Indrani Mukherjee, who's someone I'm also always glad to see, although she's barely in this. And that is clearly not a relationship that's going great between the daughter and the stepmother. Daughter is off at boarding school, and then she eventually just kind of leaves and goes, travels the world, and ends up in Kathmandu.
Okay.
As a hippie named Janice. That is the name she's going by. And then Dev is looking for her. And so he then lands in Kathmandu and is following her around town and trying to talk with her. Why he does not immediately say to her, I'm your brother, is very unclear to me. That doesn't come out until the end. I think he's trying to get her to remember on her own for some reason that I don't fully understand. I don't know what, because Prem Chopra is there and is kind of like trying to be, and there's another guy who's Zenit's kind of like maybe on again, off again boyfriend or whatever. And he's really jealous and people keep beating up Devon and he keeps getting in fights. And then there's a theft of an idol from a shrine that also is mixed up in there, which is not super important. And Dev then falls for Mumtaz, who is a local girl who's a dancer. And her part's very small. And I feel like that could have been played by kind of anyone. I feel a bit bad for Mumtaz in this film. She's like, it does not make full use of her amazing talent. So, I'm going to give us, I have a spoiler for the end of this film, if you don't know, because should I give it?
Yeah, it's an old movie.
Yeah, so eventually the parents come to Kathmandu and Dev kind of, I don't think that they exactly reunite, but they and Dev are going to, you know, they want to see the daughter and he says, can you take me? They ask if they can, he can take them to her and he does. And then, you know, she's found out he's her brother and she dies by suicide.
Why?
Shame, question mark, I guess, for her like hippie lifestyle. And she did steal some of her dad's money and it was quite a bit of money, but like he's not impoverished or anything. She didn't ruin him. He's like some business dude. So
that is so strange.
Yeah, it's really awful. And I've never heard the ending before. Somehow I'd never clocked that with this movie because, like I said, most of the conversations I've ever had about it are about the music and the fashion.
Yeah.
So it's a bit preachy, although it's not as heavy. I don't want to say it's not heavy handed, but I don't know. It's somehow a little more subtle or something, but it's also like, it's pretty easy to look back on dirty hippies of the 60s and laugh at them, you know, and to laugh at their oversimplification as it's at least presented in this film of like peace, love, understanding, blah, blah, blah. Some cultural appropriation, we would now say, right, about aspects of Hinduism that foreigners are just sort of picking up and playing with and whatever. But I don't think she's done anything that's really, I don't see why that was something that crossed her mind and all. So again, is she presented as having a mental illness? I don't know. That's not what I was getting from this film. So I don't really know where this came from. It felt very out of left field to me.
I thought the end would be like one giant happy family and yay, Dave is the wonderful older brother who brought them together. I was not expecting you to say suicide.
Also, I did not know that Dev Anand directed this film, and it is only his second as a director. Kind of like it's got some Nevketan style to it. You know, the Kathmandu looks beautiful wherever, I'm assuming that's where they actually are. I don't know it well enough to recognize it, but wherever they are is beautiful. The architecture is fascinating. You know, so I thought there were some great visuals in it. There's some good music. It's Ardy Burman, of course. And the background score is really strong and interesting, which I think he also did. I have not been able to find out otherwise. So there's a lot to like about this film. It drags a little bit, especially because you're like, just tell her you're her brother, dude. Like, just, that just goes on and on forever. These cycles of him kind of like following her around and she doesn't, you know, people are telling him to leave her alone, blah, blah, blah. Like, and you're like, yeah, this is a bit stalkery and it's not romantic stalker, but she doesn't know that. And just tell her who you are. Like, it doesn't make any sense to me. So I'm hoping someone who's seen that can comment about like why he doesn't actually just say who he is. But you know, it's of a particular time very much, this film, you know. But yeah, hippies are annoying. I get it.
This was one of her earlier movies, right?
Yeah. So this is not her first film, but it's her first film that made any impact. She's actually done three before this, one of which I believe is a Filipino film with Dev Anand, who's also in it. So, and I just read that she was about ready to leave, you know, to leave India and go somewhere else after this film was wrapped. And Dev Anand said, please stay and let's see how it's received. It was received amazingly well.
Right.
So she stayed and the rest is history. She won the Filmfare Best Supporting Actor for this.
Supporting actor?
Yeah.
But then who's the, what? I'm very confused by that.
Yeah, I mean, there is no woman lead in this if she's the supporting actor, I guess.
Dev Anand is the lead.
Well, right. So yeah, I'm not sure why this is best supporting. And is it because she doesn't have a romantic arc? Is that what makes it supporting? You know, I don't know, but
very confusing.
I did not see the other two films that had a role that was nominated for best supporting for that year. So I can't really say, but I'm kind of surprised because I don't think it's that amazing of a performance, but you know, I think she's good. I can see why she made an impact because she is stunning to look at. And the character is obviously styled, you know, she's like she's wearing kind of skimpy clothes because she's westernized and she is Canadian, right? So she's not, and she, you know, she performs those songs well in the sort of like, again, stoned hippie kind of way, but there's a lot of like actual stoned hippies in the background. I think they sure seem like they're actually stoned. So yeah, I'm kind of surprised by the acting accolade for this one. And I wonder if Dev Anand had someone in his pocket a bit about this or something. I don't know, but I do think that she improves as an actor over time. And I, you know, by the late 70s in particular, I think she's doing really well, especially the kind of like, the vamp and the heroine have merged, as you were saying, like those kind of roles. I think she's good at that. And I am always happy to see her. So, but it was nice to kind of see this first big film for her.
Yeah.
And it did make me go back and look at my list of her films that I've seen and kind of pick out some of my favorites, which we can get to after we talk about yours.
So mine was interesting. Mine was Roti Kapda Makan, a movie that I have avoided for a very long time.
Have you avoid yard it?
I had avoid yard it for a very long time. But I really just wanted to see it because my main question was like, okay, so if she is someone that dumps Manoj Kumar's character, who is an unemployed youth, and she instead wants to be with her rich, handsome boss, Shashi Kapoor, it seems like a no-brainer to me. I just wanted to see how that was going to be portrayed. Like, was it going to be portrayed as she's an immoral, loose, terrible person, or was it going to be like, you know, I was just curious to see, and I wanted to see if there was any nuance. I wanted to see if she portrayed it well. And I was very, very shocked to discover that I actually kind of like the movie. Now, is it heavy-handed? Oh God, yes. It is very long. Manoj Kumar. Okay, so this movie is produced by, written by, directed by, edited by, and stars Manoj Kumar. So we're kind of in Feroz Khan territory here.
But this and this one was written by Dev Anand, for example. I didn't even know he wrote films. So like, yeah, we've got the real auteur thing going on
Yeah,
here.
but this is like five different things that, like, this is a Manoj Kumar movie, basically. And he looks way too old to be like a recent engineering graduate. But I was like, okay, we're definitely very familiar with like older people playing college kids at this point. But it's a very interesting movie, and it's like a So I tend to avoid 70s movies, the masala movies, because I don't like them. I pretty much only watch 70s like parallel cinema. But so this is not an era I'm super familiar with cinematically. It's also not an era that I'm familiar with socially because it was before my time. But I was very interested because the movie talks about the amount of inflation, unemployment, the poor economy in India at that time, and how difficult it was even for college graduates with really good degrees to get jobs, how difficult it was. And it was interesting to me because in that era, every single person from my father's generation, all of his cousins, my dad himself, my uncles, everybody migrated from India, and they did that because they couldn't get good jobs. And they were all extremely highly educated. Like, my father had 4 degrees, and he was finding it really difficult to get like a job of his caliber. So that's why he moved to Nigeria. And so the brain drain at that time really was real. I mean, all of my dad's cousins settled abroad, like the US, Europe, Africa, Middle East, wherever. And it's not because they wanted to, it's because they had no choice. They just couldn't get jobs in India. And whatever few jobs there would be, it would be people with connections who would get it. In fact, the movie begins with a scene where there's like there's people rioting at some sort of like factory slash office because they're saying that the interview process is a sham and that the person who's going to get the job is someone known to the hiring manager. So I found that very interesting because that's exactly what the NEPA versus outsider debate is these days, where it's like these fake auditions or whatever. So I was very interested. I also found it amazing that this movie is one of the few films I've seen that really talks about heavy subjects like the economy. It has the only song I've ever heard in all of Hindi cinema that literally is dedicated to the subject of inflation. There's a song called Mehengai Mar Gayi, which means inflation killed us.
Love
There's
it.
literal stanzas. It's all the people who work at a construction site, including
Oh,
Mashami
yeah.
Chatterjee and, you know, Madan Chopra and all these people. And there's a literal stanza where he talks about how you could use like a fistful of money to buy a heap of sugar, but now you need a fistful of no, now you need a heap full of money to buy a fistful of sugar. So
Oh.
the literal song is about inflation. I just found the movie really interesting because it talks about the things you have to do when there's no money and you're struggling. And I thought it was very well done. I loved the political commentary in it. I loved the juxtaposition of the middle class versus the poor and everything. In a weird kind of way, I know this is a stretch, but in a weird kind of way, it reminded me a little bit of Les Miserables, which I know completely different era and France and all the things, but Les Miserables is also one of the famous musicals that talks about the plight of the poor. So I really liked it. I was also very shocked that I really liked how Mousami Chatterjee's character was played in this film. So she plays a construction worker who has been gang raped by 4 men, and she has an illeg like she has a child as a result of that rape. And I'm not even sure if she knows whose child it is because it was a gang rape. I thought it was going to be treated badly, but there is a scene where you can see that Manoj Kumar and Mousami are kind of interested in each other, and she implies something to the effect of, "No, I'm a sinner," or something, which I was like, "Oh God!" And he literally says, "No, you're not. People committed a sin upon you. They did something bad to you. You're the victim here, and you didn't do anything bad." And I was like, "Holy shit! Okay." And then the Xena thing is also interesting because she's portrayed very interestingly. I think that in the hands of a really poor director and a very superficial, idiotic thinker, she could have been portrayed just as a gold digger.
Yeah.
You know, she's dumping her boyfriend who is having a really difficult time, who doesn't have any money. And it's just easier for her to fall into a marriage of convenience with her rich, handsome, sophisticated boss, Shashi Kapoor. But it's not portrayed like that. It's kind of like she does love Manoj Kumar. She cares very much for him. But his problems just don't end. And he's responsible for his whole family. And he portrays his character really well. Like, he's not just mopey dopey Manoj Kumar. He's mopey dopey, but he's also angry. He's also frustrated. He's always in a bad mood, which all of those things are understandable. He's also, like, he's just not fun to be around. And she's this girl who's, you know, she's working as a secretary. She has dreams. She has ambitions. And she's like, she wants to settle down. And so when she gets this proposal from her handsome, sophisticated boss, also very easy on the eye, Shashi Kapoor, she kind of jumps at it, but there's definitely a bit of a moral dilemma because she doesn't love him. So I thought that was played well. I thought the character was written well. I also thought it was played well. And then before she and Shashi Kapoor can get married, she actually sort of, you know, has a breakdown and actually admits that she still loves Manoj Kumar and she would rather be with him than Shashi. And then at the end, she actually dies because she takes a bullet. But I was kind of pleased by that. Not the fact that she took a bullet. I was pleased by the fact that she wasn't just portrayed as like some annoying, stupid gold digger. And, you know, it was like she wants to be upwardly mobile too. I thought that was interesting. One thing that I did not expect would happen. So I went into this movie thinking I was going to find Manoj Kumar extremely irritating. I would probably like Zenith and that I would really like Shashi. That did not happen. I actually Shashi very annoying because he played all capital letters Manic Pixie Dream Boy.
Is he goody goody also?
He
I
is
can't remember.
Fairly goody goody.
Yeah.
He's very ebullient and exuberant to the point of sounding completely tone deaf. And he is a complete man. Like, the guy is a caricature. He literally looks drunk in most of the scenes because he's like, hee-hee, like that. Like, he's like, tee-hee. At one point, I remember WhatsApp to you. I was like, I want to shake his character and be like, have you been drinking since morning? And then you replied back to me saying, well, he is a Kapoor. And I was like, true that. But it was funny because do you like P.G. Woodhouse's novels?
Yeah.
I love them. So I love Bertie Wooster. But the thing is, Bertie Wooster and his stupidity and tomfoolery and foolishness is entertaining only in that world. If you were to take Bertie Wooster out of that world and put him in like a Charles Dickens novel or something, you would slap the shit out of him because he's so living in a bubble and enjoying his privilege. So it was a little bit like that. Like, Shashi in his Bertie Woosterish avatar is great in those films. But
I can
when
see
you
that.
Take him and put him in this movie, you just want to slap him. Like, there are people getting trafficked for money. And Shashi is like drinking martinis. And I was like, yeah. But Zenith was really good in the film.
Good.
She looked like a million bucks. You would love her saris in this movie because she wears all these like 70s prints. And I sent you screenshots. She looks like so cute.
Yeah.
And there's a song in the movie called Hi Hi Yamash Buri when it's raining. And she wants to like romance Manoj Kumar. And he's like, no, he literally has his degree in his hand. And he's like, no, I have to go for a job interview. I can't get wet. So he's in the gazebo. And she's just dancing with abandon. And I was like, oh, Zenith, I will dance with you. It's really cute. So that was an interesting movie. Would I watch Roti Kapda Makan again? No. But I came away with like an appreciation for Manoj Kumar because I like that he took on a subject as weighty as economics and politics and government and supply chain. And like, I felt like I got a degree in economics 101 in the 70s or something. You know, like, I felt like I learned so much. And I was like, was this what it was like in India when like my dad's generation basically fled because the brain drain was real? And I was like, well, no wonder they left if this is how bad it was, you know? So I kind of liked it. Have you seen this movie?
I have. It's been a long time, and I meant to kind of look back through my screen grabs of it to remind myself of what all happens. But that setting of hero has a college degree but still can't get a job, that's very common in 70s in the 70s films I've seen. But obviously it is taken to a much more, it's a much lengthier, kind of more substantial part of the film in this movie. And I what you're saying about it, I wouldn't have thought of any of that, but yeah, I can absolutely see what you're saying. And I mean, Manoj Kumar does not shy away from an issue. He's just not usually doing issues that I want to see treated the way that he tends to treat them. But this one is more interesting, it sounds like.
Especially because I haven't seen anything like it. Because the only other movies that actually tackle issues like the working class and stuff, again, those are parallel movies. Those are the movies of Girish Karnad and Govind Nihalani. I'm familiar with those films, but I don't typically see masala movies tackling it. Because if masala movies tackle it, it's like it's in passing where they're like, well, all these bad things happened to me and therefore I became a gangster. You know, where it's just like in the background, it doesn't inform the whole film, typically. I mean, Kala Pathar being one of the few movies that talks about the working class, but in a masala setting.
There's another Shashi film whose name I'm trying to remember that has he and Amitabh play working class guys who are, if I recall, having economic struggles, but now I'm yeah, I don't know. There'll be a few scattered among there, I'm sure, but
So Amitabh, by the way, has a role in this movie, which I did not know. He plays Manoj Kumar's younger brother.
oh,
So
that's
Manoj
right.
Kumar, so Manoj Kumar is the oldest brother and he has two younger brothers and he has a mom and his dad dies. And so he not only needs to like feed himself, he needs to feed like a family of four because his younger brothers are still in college. And this is where you can tell the difference between a good actor and a bad. Manoj Kumar hams so much in all his scenes, and Amitabh, there is such a like, with the least bit of words and with the least bit of facial expressions, he just gets the point across. He's so effortless in those scenes. I mean, in scenes where there's Manoj and Amitabh together, and there's a scene where Manoj Kumar says something to the effect of, "What do you mean you want to leave college?" Of course, because he can't pay Amitabh's college fees. And he says, "What do you mean you want to leave college? Of course you should. You must get a degree." And Amitabh Bachchan is like, "Well, you got a degree. Fat lot of good that did you." You know, so like he loves his older brother and he wants to help him out by not making him responsible for his fees, but he's also disillusioned. But the way Manoj Kumar plays it is so shouty and ham-handed and loud, and the way Amitabh plays it with just a faint expression, like micro expressions and his eyes and like a little tone of his voice, and it's basically like, fat lot of good your degree did you. And then Manoj Kumar reacts again, overreacts. So it's like the difference in acting is so palpable. And I was like, maybe Manoj Kumar should have stuck to direction because I feel like he's a pretty decent director based on this movie alone. But like his acting is bad.
Yeah, I think I enjoy him more as a director than I do as an actor as well, and certainly more than as a writer.
I just am not super familiar with his work, is the
No, I haven't seen
thing,
a ton
because
either.
yeah, but yeah, I may be turning a little bit of a corner with Manoj Kumar. Words I
Interesting.
never thought I'd say.
Interesting.
So, who do you think was Zeenat's closest sort of? Who do you think was an actress that is most reminiscent of Zeenat? Because I know that a lot of people tend to confuse Zeenat and Parveen, or compare Zeenat and Parveen, and
Yeah,
so I
I
think
said
I
that's
can
who
see
I would say for
similarities.
sure. I definitely did get them confused when I first started watching their movies, and it took me a couple to really sort them out. I don't know why, because they don't actually look that similar to each other, but they do play some very similar kinds of roles. They're
They
both
also have that
stunning.
same physicality.
Yeah, they're dressed kind of similarly. I do think Zenit, here's what I'm going to say, and I this is a gut. I want to say this is a gut thought, but it's like I can't quite formulate this, but this is something I feel to be true. I think that on whole, Zenit is a stronger actor, but when Parveen is really good, she is better than Zenit, is what I would say.
Oh,
But that's
interesting.
kind of only occasionally. And obviously, like her career did not go the same way, and she had just a much, much. I mean, both of these women were treated terribly by men. And the fact that Zeenat managed to continue a career when Parveen did not, maybe speaks to some luck and some mental health that she had, or at least was able to support, that poor Parveen was not. And that the system just really did her very badly. In some ways it's not fair to compare after like the early 80s, because they're just, their lives are different. Just not fair. But I do, both of them, and then to a little bit, I would say Rekha and Neetu Singh get to play the more modern heroines, right? Mostly Hema Malini does not do that as much, I feel, at least in the things I've seen, with a few exceptions like Sita or Gita. All of those women are people I love to watch. They are a sign of a good time for Beth. Yeah. Like they are key in the movies that I love the most. So
right.
I'm happy to see any of their names, and, you know, asking me to, you know, you didn't ask me who I thought was a better actor, but like, don't make me choose among my favorites. You know, like, I love all of them, and I'm happy to see all of them. I will put Aruna Irani and Bindu in there, and Helen, obviously, as well. Like, this era is just jam packed with these amazing women, and a lot of amazing men too. For my dollar, so to speak. As the years go on and we move into the 80s, I'm less familiar with Zeenat's filmography. I'd say like Rena Roy is going to be in there as someone who's playing some similar kinds of films. And I like her too. I'm glad to see her. But I, you know, if I had to choose between her and Zeenat,
no prizes for guessing my favorite Rena Roy movie.
I mean, it's what is not to love.
I know.
You know, so there's something about Zeenat and Parveen, and to some extent Neetu Singh and Rekha, for me. So I was born in 1974, and these women look like the cool, like, college students my parents taught. Cool. Yeah, or like my cool babysitters or whatever when I was a little kid. And there's just something about the style in these that just is like a direct arrow to my heart. And I love it so I love it so much.
I would
much.
Add also Simi Garewal to that list, although I know she's not like a superstar by any stretch of the imagination.
Yeah. No, she's in there though. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but like, I love the way she was styled too. It's like all the thin straight hair they all had, and like the middle parting, and then the bell bottoms, and it was very cool. It was a very cool era stylistically.
Yeah, and like those kind of like disco tunic tops they wear with bell bottoms, or even with just slinky skirts, and like it is just so glamorous in a way that I really love. So it's kind of, you know, these people appear in things that I just find delightful. So, and when I have seen a couple of films. So there's one film in particular I feel like people hold up as the Zeenat as actor film, which is, I've got all these browser windows open. Please forgive me.
Is it that Insaaf Ka Tarazu movie?
That's the one.
Yeah,
that's the one. And I have seen that. And I was trying to remind myself of what exactly happens in it. For listeners who haven't seen it, it is a rape revenge film from about 1980, I believe. It's based on an American film. It's rough. If I recall correctly, it is quite hard to watch.
I think that's why I haven't seen it.
I can't.
Is it
honestly...
good though?
Yeah, I remember it as being good.
Okay.
And if I recall correctly, Raj Babar is the criminal in it. And Zeenat plays a supermodel, which obviously she can do. But she also plays the avenging angel. So
did she just walk into an office like Rekha and Kunbariman and say, "Hi, I want to be a model"? And this receptionist looks up and goes, "That way, is that how it happened?"
If I recall, she's already a model when the movie starts. So I'm not sure that we get to see that, but that would be even better. And I suspect there must be more films where people are like, "Oh, she can really act at certain moments," you know. So I would love to be pointed to those for people who can name some of them. But she's a sign of good stuff for me.
Yeah.
She's in so much that I love. And, you know, I hope she writes an autobiography. I would read the heck out of that.
You know, she might. I mean, with the Instagram following that she's starting to add up, and like, she writes these long, amazing captions on her posts. I'm pretty sure she has a book in her. The problem is, I don't know to what extent she will censor herself, just because I don't know how comfortable she's going to be talking about Mazhar Khan, or even worse, Sanjay Khan. So, but I mean, if you can write a book without mentioning those situations, then I suppose, but I don't know. She has steadfastly maintained silence on both those men. It kind of is gobsmacking to me that someone as accomplished and phenomenal as her, I mean, she had some terrible men in her life. Mm-hmm. I bet she worked with people like Shashi Kapoor, and she was like, I need a guy like this in my life. Like, you know, but he was already taken. Question for you. Has Zenith ever been paired with Kabir Bedi? Because I feel like they would just look like a million bucks.
Oh, they would. I don't know. I have her filmography here, so let me do some looking. But I do feel that would be an excellent pairing. What a good idea. Kabir Bedi, really one of the heroes of the Filmy Ladies podcast so far.
Oh, I love him. I will never get tired of mentioning him. He is gorgeous. He actually exemplifies the 70s to me, because like he is the most gorgeous man of the 70s, and his like paisley shirts with satin and the shirts open until the waist and the long beautiful locks and the gold chain and the bell bottoms. Such a gorgeous person.
So they are only in three films together, according to IMDb. And one of them is that movie Dunno Why from 2010. So I don't know what I don't know what their relationship is in that. One of her films before Hare Rama was called Hulchul, and they're both in that, though again, I don't know if they are romantically paired. And then he is also in Ishq, Ishq, Ishq with her and Devanand and Shabana Azmi, and boy, that's a weirdo cast. So I haven't seen that. That is one of the films I feel like I hear people making fun of Devanand for, is by that point, like the color film world has tipped, and like poor Dev is on his way to mockability at that point, I think. So I have not seen that. Maybe I should. And the Ishq, Ishq, Ishq sounds like one of those fake films that movies about movies have their people be in. And maybe people do that on purpose to make fun of this film. I don't know. But so that seems like a lack. Those two should be together. It's not too late.
That was an oversight. No.
Not too late. They would really shizzle it up still.
I would watch it.
Oh, yeah.
My favorite Devanand screenshot, not that you asked, is there's a photo of him where him and his son are in front of like a photo of his like dead mother. And it's a photo, and there's like the mala around it because it's like his dead mom. And the photo is of Cindy Crawford.
That's a classic. Yeah. Yeah.
I love that. Only Devanand could do it. I mean, I will say this. I know this is the Zenith episode and not the Devanand episode, but I will say, I wish I had a modicum of the confidence that man had.
Yeah, I mean, self-confidence. Bar none.
Just out of the wazoo. We need a bracelet. Like, you know, those What Would Jesus Do bracelets? We need a bracelet that says, What Would Dave Do? So anytime I have like imposter syndrome, or I'm nervous, or I'm anxious, and I'm like, oh my God, maybe I can do this, I'll look at my bracelet and be like, no, I can also floppy hat Devanand into this. Just channel him.
There's so many of those. Like, I would have a Feroz Khan one.
Yeah. Swagger.
I would have a Rekha one. What would Rekha do? She would just do it anyway.
She would just whip you. Yeah. Just smithereens. And you would ask for more.
One of the things I really like about Zeenat Aman is that I just, like, there is maybe this is the roles rather than her, but I don't want to take credit away from her, because you can have a good role and still perform it badly or ineffectively or whatever, right? But there is this like energy or something I find in her. Wow. Like, I just, she's like, I don't know. She comes off as like fun to be around and like, let's go dancing. And
I think she's likable. Is the thing.
Yeah.
She's likable, relatable, despite being extremely glamorous.
And it's not quite Girl Next Door. It's a different it's a different feeling than that. But it's like, is it like a new brand of a new spirit of youthfulness of a particular kind of sub-generation or something. Like, I don't know what it is, but I just really, I find her very engaging and kind of like energizing. Parveen also, I will say, like, both of them have that, I think. And so again, maybe part of it's the roles and stuff, but it's like, yeah, I want to hang out with her.
Like, she's there. She's doing stuff. She's not just like hanging out. Like, she's always doing something. She's always being glamorous. She's always being funny. She's being witty. Mm-hmm. She's being confident. She's always bringing it, I think, is the thing. There's a lack of passivity to her, which there's a lot of actresses that are super passive. And it's just kind of like, okay, do something. You're on camera, please.
And it's not that there's sort of one of the words I'm tempted to use is like a freshness or something.
Yeah.
And it's not that, you know, every now and again, you know, when people are like, oh, I like women to look natural, I don't like makeup. And you're like, yeah, that takes 30 minutes, that no makeup that you like. So I think it's not that she's not like slathered in makeup, because she usually is, I think, and all that kind of thing. But there's just something kind of like vital and
yeah. Maybe a little bit free-spirited, like she gives
something like that.
Not necessarily like free-spirited as in bohemian or hippie, more like free-spirited as in like extremely confident, and she's going to do what she wants to do, which is a quality I also find much later in Sushmita Sen.
Oh, yes, I can see that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like I do not like Sushmita Sen, the actor, because I don't think she's particularly good, but she's always so... She's such a breath of fresh air to watch. She's such a good speaker. She's so eloquent. And I will always watch her songs, at least. Like, I like watching her in Chunuri Chunuri and things like that. But it's that same thing of where it's like, she's going to tell you something new. And she has something fresh to offer, like a fresh perspective, perhaps. Mm-hmm. And it's not as, like, rote and cookie cutter and, like, old wine in a new bottle, if that makes sense. But, like, I know what you're talking about. And I feel like much later, Sushmita had that. There's a lack of jadedness, perhaps, maybe.
Mm-hmm. What are your favorite Zeenat Aman films?
That's hard to answer, because I don't think I have favorite Zeenat Aman films. I think I have favorite Zeenat Aman songs.
Okay. What are some of those?
Oh my God, so many. I love all of her songs from Roti Kapra Makan, all of her songs from Hare Rama Hare Krishna. I like her songs from like Grey Gambler.
Grey Gambler.
Like the
is
one, the gondola is so nice. I mean, she had some like really banger soundtracks. There's a really amazing song of hers that is worth watching for the video alone. It's with Rajesh Khanna. I think it's from that movie where I told you that she wants to get an abortion because she doesn't want the baby to impact her career. But they're in a truck. They're in the back of a truck, and there's like a lot of hay in it. Mm. And she's in a pistachio green chiffon sari. Looks like a million bucks. And the song is Hum Dono Do Premi Duniya Chhod Chale. Jeevan ki hum sari rasme tod chale. It's a very like kanto se khich ke achal type song. Like, it's very like, let's have fun. We don't care. We're just two lovers, young and rebellious. And, you know, it's like, because I think they're eloping in that song. She's so cute in that. Mm. I think she like really always brought it. And then, of course, her song from Yaadon Ki Baraat, the most famous one, where she styled so beautifully with the little choker and the white outfit and the pin straight hair and the guitar. I mean, she really knew her camera angles. She's really beautiful in that too. I kind of a little bit like one of her songs from Satyam Shivam Sundaram, even though the movie's so horrific.
Yeah.
It's the one where she's wearing that very Vijayanti Mala Amrapali type outfit. Chanchal Komal Nirmal Sheetal, that song. But then it just gets icky and I can watch like 2 minutes of the video and I'm like, okay, I'm done. So yeah, what about you?
I can't even name you the songs, but yeah, I'm always happy to see her in a song. And again, partly that's the outfit. I don't get the sense she's particularly strong as a dancer. But like, she's got some of that kind of disco and like, again, more like maybe
the Qurbani
less
songs. How could I forget the Qurbani songs?
Yeah.
But I mean, we did speak about them at length in the Feroz Khan episode. Yeah. She looks so good in Feroz Khan movies, like so good.
And again, that like kind of modern, I do what I want, I'm a good person, but like I'm confident and like that kind of thing fits his films really well. So there's a couple of films I wanted to name simply because I feel like they don't get a ton of attention. Well, first of all, here's one I haven't seen. I found it, but I didn't find it with subtitles, but I will probably watch it. It is with Dev Anand. It is called Kalabaz, and they play trapeze artists.
Oh, okay.
So obviously, your friend Beth is all about that.
Yes.
I'm going to watch it. It sounds
Does a
really
lion
ridiculous.
Eat Devanand at the end?
Huh?
Does a lion eat Devanand at the end?
I suspect not.
Okay.
But it does have a thing that I know you like, which is like an
What?
extreme accident that causes facial disfigurement.
Yes!
And then what will we do?
Then there will be a plastic surgeon, ideally Dr. Shami Kapoor.
The two I want to name are Tisri Ankh, which is an 80s film with Dharmendra. It's got three brothers and their three love interests, and like it's a big crazy masala thing. And it's got a people may have heard a song called Superman that's in it. It doesn't have Superman in it, but it's like that. But that's just like a massive masala on steroids kind of film that I really, really love. And it got a very particular brand of like Dharmendra as stompy hero that I like. And then there's another one from the mid 70s called Chori Mera Kaam that has Zeenat, Shashi, Pran, and Ashok Kumar. And like, you wouldn't necessarily think those four people are like comedy gold. Those people are comedy gold. I cannot say enough good things about this film. I really hope people will watch
it.
Ashok
Kumar is always comedy gold.
Devin Verma is in it. He won a Filmfare for comedian, I think, for it. Like, it's just the Kalyanji and Anji soundtrack. It's so much fun. This is a kind of a comfort movie for me. I've seen it several times, but I feel like it's one that people don't talk about very much. But please go watch Chori Mera Kaam. It is extremely funny to me, and I think it's very underrated. And she's very good in it. And she and Shashi are fun in it.
I want to see Hirappanna. I've never seen it, but
I
was
haven't
sending
seen
you
that either.
Screenshots. Was I sending you screenshots for it? Because so Hira means diamond and Panna means emerald. And so Dev Anand's name is Hira in the movie and her name is Panna. And so there's a song in it that says, the songs in that movie are so good. And there's a song where she says, Hira ki tamanna hai ki Panna mujhe mil jaye. No, Panna ki tamanna hai ki Hira mujhe mil jaye. And it's like the whole song is about how much she desperately wants to be with him. And I'm like, girl, but it's Dev Anand, why?
Girl, but why?
Yeah, why?
That's the thing we can say to Zeenat Aman overall, unfortunately. It's girl, but why?
In general, I know. Like, Zeenat and the men in her movies, like, at least the ones that you and I spoke with today, it's like, you know, she's Barbie, he's just Ken.
I'm trying to decide if Manoj Kumar would, I mean, he could never be just contained to being just Ken. His job is
he
never
would
just
never be
beach.
Ken.
His job is
he
Bharat.
He's Bharat Beach. No, he could be the CEO of Mattel or something. I don't know. He would be something, but I can't imagine him as Beach Ken. Like, no, that could not be.
No, he's not Beach
Maybe
Ken.
He could run that like Casa, Dojo Casa, whatever, Mojo House.
I feel like he would be all about Mojo Dojo Casa House. I keep saying Mojo Jojo like it's the Powerpuff Girls. Mojo Dojo Casa House.
Yeah. What was I saying? I lost it. Oh yeah. So in Hirappanna, there is also another. I'm very familiar with the songs of Hirappanna because I enjoy them very much. There's a song in which I feel like Dev Anand is a photographer in this movie, or at least in this song. And I think
is
Zeenat
she
is
a
a
model?
model. I
Yeah.
think she is.
Yeah.
And in the whole song, he's just following her around to like these places, like she's in a hammock, she's standing, she's by a tree, and he's just taking her picture. And the song is Main Tasveer Utarta Hoon, like I take pictures, Bikri Hui Haseeno Ki, of all these beautiful women. And it's just kind of like Dev Anand being a weirdo.
That tracks.
I really want to read his biography, like desperately.
I think we need to do that as a book club installment.
I feel like we should.
It's
because
so long though, isn't it? Isn't it like this big,
it's
huge,
like very big.
My
library
novel?
doesn't even have it, but I discovered that Stanford Library in Palo Alto has it. I was like, why does Stanford have Dev Anand's biography? Maybe their medical center, like Department of Psychiatry, reads it or something. It's like a manual. But like, I'm actually going to try and get like an interlibrary loan, and I want Stanford. Also, it has never been checked out.
Yes. Check that book out. Make sure it stays in circulation. I'll try to get it too. That'd be fun.
Yeah, we should do it.
Because
it would be a lot
he,
of fun.
I mean, he would offer probably, I suspect there's a lot in there about Zeena Daman, at least.
Yes.
Well, even if not a lot, but they clearly they work together a lot. So that, and I suspect that was largely driven by him because men.
Yes.
So I, you know, it'd be interesting to see.
Didn't
what
she
he has to
recently
say.
Post an Instagram post about him though, where she said that there
I
was
don't
like
know.
a rumor? Yeah, something to the effect of there was a rumor that was started about him or something. I don't know. I need to go back and check her Instagram. But yeah. Are you hoping, do you think she might make a comeback to the movies just because like
I was
she
thinking
just came out
about,
in an ad?
yeah, I did see that ad. I don't know. I mean, if she wants to, I would be very glad to see her. If she's just enjoying herself on Instagram, then more power to her to do what it is that she's doing there. And like, you know, I think we talked about this in the Reka episode that, you know, she and Reka were both on the covers of magazines recently, and like how exciting that is to see these,
Yeah.
older women being, you know, being glamorous in ways that they used to be and were famous for.
Yeah.
And hopefully they enjoy. I get the sense that both of them do enjoy this. And so then more power to
yeah.
them.
I think Zenith had recently posted a picture of herself and Rekha from back in the day. It's like the Mahurat of some film, it's a black and white film. And I've already seen it. Something like five people sent it to me because they were like, thought you might enjoy this. And I was like, how
correct.
white people
I
know
would
me.
Enjoy that.
I was like, I did enjoy that very much. Thank you.
Yeah.
I will take more of these pictures.
This does make me want to go look at all the old film fairs and find some of her.
Yeah.
You know, find some
it
pictures
makes
of
me
her.
It makes me want to watch her old interviews. Like I'm
Oh,
sure
yeah.
there's lots of old like video interviews of hers. I'm just very curious to see what she had to say in those. But yeah. Okay. I think that's it for our Zeeny Baby episode. So you guys let us know what you think in the comments. Hopefully you love Zenith as much as we do. Tell us which of her films you like, what you think distinguishes her from the other actresses and makes her so beloved, because the 70s is a very packed arena with some really strong performers. So being able to hold your own among all of those big names is a big deal. So tell
and
us
to
what
not
you
and
think.
To not get buried by the kind of machismo that the men are, not
Yes.
always, but there's that, you know, the sort of action masala of a lot of those men. It can
to hold
I
your
feel
own
like
against them. Yeah.
Most of these women can really hold their own against them, and I think there's something really special about that, or at least there's something that they learned how to do. So, well, that is special. Like there's something there about how they could pair with this other kind of stuff that's happening.
Yeah.
But yeah, I would be very interested to know what people think is very unique about Zenith and that sets her apart from the other, even that kind of peer group that we're naming. And maybe there's someone, I hope there's no one from the 70s I'm forgetting. Please forgive me, 70s gods. You know, Zenith is almost like if Helen were allowed to do full roles, right? This would be
yeah.
Zenith in a way. And every now and again,
exactly.
Helen is allowed full roles. But, you know, there's just so much to love.
Yeah. Well, thank you for watching this episode of Filmy Ladies. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. And we will see you next week with another episode. Whee! Bye! Thank you!